Several lies have been invented recently against Islam regarding Prophet Muhammad's marriage to Aisha. These lies manipulate invented interpretations that contradict the legislation of all the four Islamic schools of thought or madhahib. The first lie claims that Prophet Muhammad forced Aisha's father to accept the marriage.
This lie distorts a summarized narration about Abu Bakr. The detailed hadith narrated by Aisha herself provides four facts that disprove the lie. First, Prophet Muhammad did not initiate the engagement. Khawla suggested the marriage because the companions feared for the Prophet's health after the death of Khadija. Second, the Prophet did not approach Abu Bakr directly. Rather, using the applicable etiquette, he replied to Khawla's suggestion, "So go and mention me to them." Third, Abu Bakr's question to Khawla, "Is she good for him? She is his brother's daughter," was not an objection, rather a question due to the pre-Islamic norm that assigned blood ties which don't actually exist, such as in adoption. The Prophet corrected this false notion to Khawla. Fourth, if Abu Bakr had any hesitation, he would simply have used the acceptable justification that she was already engaged, but instead he told Khawla to wait and went immediately to request permission from Aisha's previous fiancé. More importantly, even the consummation itself was urged by Abu Bakr, which disproves any reluctance from his side. Lady Aisha narrated, "Abu Bakr told him, 'What prevents you from consummating with your wife?' So he consummated our marriage." Furthermore, any doubt about Abu Bakr's compassion for his daughter's best interests is rejected, because he was very well known for his shafaqa, which is a term normally used to praise a compassionate father. As a result, not only did Abu Bakr consent, but both the engagement and the consummation were initiated and urged by people other than the Prophet.
The second lie claims that sexual acts were performed when Aisha was 6 years old.
The lie does not cite any hadith, but merely repeats a falsified fatwa against Saudi scholars who denied ever having mated as declared on their website. In Islam, approaching one's wife intimately, even without penetration, is only allowed if she has reached puberty, إذا بلغت, as stated by Hassan al-Basri, leader of the followers of the companions. The relevant hadith by Aisha proves that she had passed puberty because she said, "The Prophet used to tell us during our period to wear a skirt before physically approaching us." Therefore, the only sexual acts with prepubescent girls were actually just fantasized in the perverted imagination of the person fabricating the lie in his sick mind about thighing and rubbing repeatedly a 6-year-old girl.
The third lie claims that Lady Aisha had not reached puberty when her marriage was consummated.
The fallacy claims that the proof of Aisha's childhood is her saying that her dolls were with her when she was taken to his house as a bride, when she was 9. But Ibn Hajar cites in Fath al-Bari that the Muslim scholars deduced from the context of this hadith the permission to play with dolls, regardless of age, as a means to learn about matters of the home and raising children. Indeed, playing with dolls by adults is also common in many recent societies as educational preparation for motherhood. It's ridiculous to claim that merely playing with dolls or swings is evidence of physical or even mental maturity. The evidence for Aisha's adulthood is quite explicit. First, as shown in part 1 of this presentation, even until the 18th century, psychological maturity coincided with puberty, and all societies recognized puberty as the requirement to give informed consent for marriage. Second, in her parents' opinion, Aisha had reached puberty and was fit for marriage when Abu Bakr requested the consummation, just like the Jewish princess Sophia, who married when she became capable of marriage in her neighboring Jewish tribe. Third, Lady Aisha said, "If the young girl reaches 9 years, then she is a woman." She's obviously describing herself and her acquaintances. Fourth, Not merely did she reach menstruation, the great Maliki scholar Dawoodi commented about her marriage, Aisha then had physically matured well indeed. As a result, not only had Lady Aisha reached puberty when her marriage was consummated, she was also a physically and psychologically mature adult.
The fourth lie dares to claim that Aisha did not consent to the marriage.
Not only did she consent to the marriage according to Islam's requirements, Lady Aisha was overjoyed and stated six privileges directly relating to her marriage. I have been given features not given to any woman. The Prophet married me when I was 7. The angel brought him my image in his hand to look at it. He consummated our marriage when I was 9. I saw the angel Gabriel. I was his most beloved wife. I attended his disease till he died, not witnessed but by me and the angels. It's clear from this hadith that Aisha not only consented, but was even ecstatic about this privilege.
The fifth lie claims that Islam permits consummation to prepubescent girls.
To disfigure the truth, the fallacy omits the very first verse revealed regarding the waiting period after divorce in the correct context and order. The first verse sets the waiting period to 3 menstrual cycles. Since old and young women don't menstruate, the second verse was subsequently revealed, setting their waiting period to 3 months, as explained by Ibn Kathir. And finally, the third verse sets the exception for any marriage that hasn't been consummated. This exception applies to marriages that can't be consummated, such as not only prepubescent girls, but even women who have menstruated but are not yet ready physically or emotionally for intercourse. In fact, the only verse in the Quran using the term bulugh al-nikah, or age of procreation, to describe puberty mentions the additional requirement of mental maturity for orphans to receive their financial assets. This Islamic requirement of maturity, which is even correctly relayed in Encyclopedia Britannica, undeniably applies even more to marriage contracts because it entails responsibility towards other people. Furthermore, Imam Abu Hanifa legislated that since a woman who reached puberty has authority over her own financial affairs, then she has authority over her own marriage. Consummation before puberty cannot occur because it would violate this right of women to consent. Indeed, an authentic hadith shows that a young girl who was still a virgin came to the Prophet, and she mentioned that her father married her to someone while she was forced, so the Prophet gave her the choice to remain married or not. As a result, prior to consummating a marriage, Islam not only requires puberty, but physical and mental maturity followed by consent as well.
The sixth ridiculous claim is that Muhammad invented Islam to satisfy his sexual desires.
First of all, there were already Talmud and church laws permitting vast sexual aberrations. But while affirming the divine source of Judaism and Christianity, Islam rejected these obviously false interpretations or alterations. Please read the following examples. Secondly, Islam actually opposed the extreme sexual permissiveness of that time, such as Therefore, to satisfy abnormal sexual desires in 7th century Arabia, no new religion was needed. All one had to do was take his pick from the existing religions and norms. In contrast, Islam protected people from these shameful laws.
In conclusion, these attacks against Islam necessitated disfiguration, concealing the truth, and incompetent, twisted interpretations. They also put into serious question the morality, system of values, and beliefs of anyone perpetrating such lies.